Hey yo les gens, c'est Kero, j'espère que vous allez bien. Et waouh, que ça me fait extrêmement plaisir de vous retrouver sur ce jeu. C'est bien sûr Metal Gear Solid 5 The Phantom Pain pour mon let's play pour la suite. Et c'est l'épisode 71 il me semble. Et ouais, ça fait une semaine, voire une semaine et demie grand max que j'ai pas joué au jeu parce que je vous ai dit, j'ai pris quelques épisodes d'avance. Donc voilà, j'ai cru que l'absence allait être plus longue que ça, mais finalement non. Donc voilà, je suis plutôt content de vous retrouver sur ce jeu. Et donc rappelez-vous, la dernière fois on avait fait une mission secondaire, donc pour vous faire écouter quelques cassettes. Il nous en reste encore pas mal, je vais vous montrer ça. Il nous en reste 22, attendez, peut-être s'il y a des... Non, il nous reste bien 22 cassettes encore à faire écouter, c'est ce qui est beaucoup encore. Donc on verra si ça sera durant cet épisode. Je ferai quelques missions secondaires ou une prochaine fois, vu qu'on approche vraiment, mais vraiment de la fin du jeu. Voilà, je vais pas vous le cacher. Là, il nous reste, sans compter cet épisode, je pense qu'il nous reste, allez, 2-3 épisodes grand max avant la fin du jeu. Voilà, donc ouais, ça, on approche. Et donc, voilà, la dernière fois, ben, on avait fait une mission secondaire, ça s'était bien passé. Voilà, j'ai pris mon temps pour la faire, mais avant de se quitter, j'ai dit on va prendre un petit point de vue pour bien sympathique. Donc vous savez, en Afghanistan là, dans les ruines là où je kiffe cet endroit et tout, mais malheureusement il y avait une mission secondaire à cet endroit-là. Donc on verra pour y retourner, pour prendre notre revanche entre guillemets. Et mais avant toute chose, je vais un petit peu voir. Donc vous voyez, liste des missions, il n'y a pas des trucs en jaune des missions importantes. On va juste aller checker. Donc vous voyez, celle-là je l'avais testée, bon c'était un échec total. D'ailleurs je voulais la faire de mon côté, mais bon, vu que j'ai pas eu le temps, donc voilà, j'ai pas retouché à cette mission. Donc écoutez, on va aller à la Mother Base voir s'il y a quelque chose qui se déclenche, sinon on partira en mission secondaire. Écoutez, hop. Donc aussi, vous avez vu, je vous ai retrouvé directement dans l'hélico, c'est plus simple parce que dès que j'ai lancé le jeu, je m'étais retrouvé encore dans la mission secondaire là, sans le vouloir. Du coup, je l'ai pas fait, je suis parti et voilà quoi. C'est rien passé d'intéressant quoi. Donc, est-ce qu'on va avoir droit à une petite cinématique, vous pensez? On va voir ça. Bon, c'était pas cette cinématique que je pensais, mais bon, c'est tout mignon et tout. Dido qui vient nous lécher tout. Bah, comme vous voyez, je vous ai pas menti, ça fait bien plus d'une semaine que j'ai pas retouché au jeu, donc ça fait assez longtemps. Et du coup, il y a Dido qui m'a sauté dessus et enfin, soit qu'il a dit t'absentes pas longtemps, c'est mauvais pour les soldats et tout. Enfin voilà. Mais bon, c'est assez chelou parce que D-Dog il était avec nous dans l'hélicoptère, enfin je l'ai pas montré, mais il était avec nous, je pense que vous l'avez entendu. Et là il se retrouve sur la Mother Base, voilà, c'est assez chelou. Bon, donc du coup, ben écoutez, on va rappeler l'hélico et puis on va partir en mission secondaire et puis on y retournera une autre fois, enfin en fin d'épisode à la Mother Base pour voir si cette fameuse cinématique se déclenche. Ah, j'ai un petit peu spoilé parce qu'il y avoir une petite cinématique assez sympathique qui va s'enclencher très bientôt. Allez. Ça, je sais pas si je pourrais terminer les cassettes aujourd'hui, ça m'étonnerait. Puisqu'il y en a 22 encore à vous faire écouter. Les autres, bah, comme je vous ai dit, je vous les ferai écouter dans un épisode bonus. Je mettrai en non répertorié la vidéo, voilà, parce que c'est comme ça. Je mettrai un lien dans l'épisode final en disant si vous voulez écouter les dernières cassettes, ça se passe sur ce lien, et puis voilà. Il est trop beau avec le bandana, notre big boss. C'est parti. Je sais même plus si je l'ai dit. Je crois que si, c'est l'épisode 71, celui-là. Donc l'épisode final devrait se trouver dans les épisodes 73-74. Voilà. Ça en aura fait beaucoup d'épisodes. C'est mon plus gros let's play sur ma chaîne pour l'instant. Donc. Liste secondaire. On va prendre notre revanche sur la mission en Afghanistan, clairement. Donc c'était laquelle? Pas celle-là. Pas celle-là non plus. Extrayer le prisonnier, c'est pas ici. Elle est où cette mission? Déminage. Non. Éliminer l'unité blindée. L'agent de renseignement, non. Unité de char. Oui, c'est ça. Ouais, c'est vrai qu'il y avait des... J'avais vu des chars et tout, donc... ouais, c'est vrai. Donc, eh ben, écoutez, on est parti. Non, on va pas atterrir ici, très clairement. On va se mettre ici. Hop. Et là, on va devoir sortir l'artillerie lourde. C'est-à-dire... le bazooka. Hop. Voilà. Arme secondaire, on est pas mal. Merde. Hop. Ici, c'est bon... choix coéquipier, on va laisser... je laisse D-Dog ou pas? Ouais, allez, on laisse D-Dog. Choix du personnage, on est bon, le bandana et tout. Je laisse la tenue d'infiltration. Et on est parti! Donc, comme la dernière fois, je vais prendre mon temps pour faire la mission, vous faire bien écouter les cassettes et tout. Pas faire de bêtises. Ça, moi, ça me permettra de pas parler, de me concentrer et tout. Et donc, je pense que la cinématique, soit on l'aura en fin d'épisode, soit la prochaine fois. Et la prochaine fois, normalement, il y a une mission que j'attends, soit à la fois avec impatience, mais à la fois, je suis tout excité. Et puis, je sais que ça me rend tout bizarre, cette mission, vous allez voir. Même si j'ai déjà vu plein de fois sur des vidéos sur YouTube et tout, c'est incroyable cette mission, vous verrez. Bref, j'en dis pas plus. Mais bon, déjà vous me voyez tout excité, ça veut dire que ça promet quoi. Désolé, je me suis gratté l'œil, je sais pas si ça s'est entendu au micro. Alors... on va prendre notre revanche. Parce qu'à la fin on a failli se faire défoncer là par l'hélico et puis par les mecs et tout. Donc là cette fois-ci, c'est moi qui va vous prendre par surprise les mecs. Vous allez voir comment ça se passe. Waouh. Trop beau ce jeu, j'ai pas envie de le quitter. Ah, il est trop beau. Il est sublime. Hop. T'inquiète pas. Alors, déjà on va placer un petit marqueur. Donc, non, c'est pas celle-là, c'est l'unité de char, voilà, c'est celle-là. Hop. Je vais commencer à vous faire écouter les cassettes sur le chemin. C'est parti. Donc on s'est arrêté où? Objectif de Skullface, une fois de plus. Origine de Skullface et de l'Axof, la cible de la vengeance de Skullface. Donc voilà, plein de choses intéressantes, je vais y arriver. Donc je vous dis... à tout de suite pour conclure, parce que voilà, je pense vous retrouver une fois que j'aurai terminé la mission. Allez, à tout de suite.
Skullface, real name unknown. Born in Hungary, more specifically northern Transylvania, after it reverted to Hungary from Romania. While he was young, the country allied with Germany as part of the Axis powers, but later during the war, it came under Soviet occupation. The Hungarians struggled for independence, but the Soviets came down. Hard. Just like he said, time and again, the country was ruled by a foreign tongue. When he was a young boy, he lost his native language, the bedrock for any developing child. His country, his family, his face, his identity, everything was stolen from him. All he had left was his skull. Skullface first tried his hand at espionage during all the chaos from the war. Agents, military officials, and soldiers who operated out of Hungary during the war vanished over the course of several months. This Soviet spy hunt rocked the counter-intel world. Mysterious fatal illnesses, accidental deaths, drownings, people having strokes behind closed doors. Just like Stalin, no one knew who was behind it. But all you need to do was look for who had the motive. They were all taken out by a man without a face. And now we've got an idea of how he did it, too. He'd gotten revenge for his people, but he wasn't finished. Skullface defected to the West, eventually ended up with the SAS. That's where he met Zero. It's possible he began planning this whole thing back then. It's hard to say. In any case, Zero made him his XO. He always did have a thing for oddballs. But this one was set to lead a unit no one else would know about. When Zero created Fox, he also formed XOF as a support team. An unconventional special forces unit designed to support Fox, make it stronger. With Skullface given the orders. Zero never even told the boss about it. Nor the CIA, naturally. If Fox was Zero's silver bullet, XOF was the recoil when he pulled the trigger. Just like Newton's third law. While you were with Fox, Skullface was operating behind the scenes. Sometimes as your backup, sometimes as a mole or a scout, sometimes as your cleanup crew. Fox's tail, making sure the mission succeeded and that you survived. We only have his word to go on, but Skullface's goal was revenge against those who'd use language to subjugate people. Those corrupting a people's identity by forcing a new tongue on them. Those using the power of language to control information. Naturally, that set his sights on Zero. To Zero, English was simply the most convenient code. But to Skullface, English was a parasite. And by eradicating it, he'd stop the world from being eaten away. If that didn't work, he was ready to see the world scorched by nuclear fire. To save language, culture, and race from annihilation, he was willing to overstep the hands of the doomsday clock. That is, of course, if you believe anything he had to say. Boss, we gave Ralph, that kid who died in... a burial at sea. The man in charge of that facility has been severely punished. But ever since, the kids have been acting strange. It's obvious they've lost their trust in adults. I was getting reports of them ignoring the staff, or getting insolent, and even violent. And a few days later, several of the kids did a disappearing act. They snuck into choppers and shipping containers and got off base. Why? Your guess is as good as mine. These kids were born in a war zone, and forced to grow up as war fighters. If they're left alone, war is how they'll die. But I thought we showed them there are other reasons to live. I never liked having children on Mother Base. But the thought of them going back to the battlefield and picking up
their own style... He's coming too. Roger that.
...something I can't stomach. It makes me think of Chico, 9 years ago. We have to get those kids back. Hell, they know too much about our operation. I never expected even the kids to betray us.
Huh? remember the White Mamba. Of course, he's been going by Eli since we brought him on base. He was the leader of the child soldier unit we took out of that village and into our protection. Well, according to the kids you brought back here, all the escapees were especially close to Eli. There's reason to suspect he's behind all six escapes. We've already detained him. I'll be questioning him shortly.
You'll be?
Ocelot.
You're incapable of taking an impartial stance with those kids. Question them all you want. It'll get you nowhere.
Ocelot, you get too many kicks from your art of interrogation.
It's not a matter of art. It's about quick, minimal strokes of psychological warfare. That's what gets the answers.
He's coming too. Roger that.
Questioner and subject safe. The risks only increase the more an interrogation drags on. At that point, it causes as much pain to the inflictor as the inflicted.
Like I said, too many kicks.
What I'm trying to tell you is we need quick results. Otherwise, it'll be too little, too late.
I know that.
And besides, I know the subject. I won't go overboard with a kid.
Forget it. You're not needed. Snake, we'll want to question the other kids too. Be sure to bring them all back.
Alors, tout le monde. Donc vous voyez, j'ai utilisé les grenades somnifères pour aller plus vite parce que ça commençait à devenir long. Donc voilà, on en a appris un petit peu plus sur les objectifs de Skullface et sur Eli aussi, ce que j'ai pu voir. Donc je vais pas y revenir dessus, je reviendrai à la fin du let's play si j'y pense de tout ça. Donc là on va continuer le chemin. Donc on va continuer les cassettes écoutées. Là on est plutôt bien parti alors que j'ai une liste de tâches de défi, on va aller voir ça. Capturer 25 postes de garde. Ok. Et donc on va continuer, il nous reste 18 cassettes. Est-ce que vous pensez qu'on va pouvoir tout faire? Surtout que c'est des petites cassettes, vous voyez, ça dure même pas 2 minutes à chaque fois. C'est plutôt cool. L'évasion pardon, des enfants, donc l'explication d'Eli, donc ça va être, on va en savoir plus pourquoi il a fait tout ça. Donc à tout de suite.
Snake, about the escaped children. Eli confessed. The way he tells it, they wanted to go back to the battlefield. Don't rob them of their freedom, he said. If you bring them all back, there will be consequences. Next to be asking for our surrender.
Consequences? What consequences?
No idea. That's all I have for now.
You're too attached to those kids. Stop protecting Eli.
Listen to yourself.
Let me question him, and we'll get some real answers.
Not necessary. I'll report as and when.
On y est arrivé sur place, les copains. Vous voyez que l'hélicoptère qui nous a cassé la tête la dernière fois, il est là. Donc là, maintenant, je vais pas trop parler. Voilà, je vais faire défiler les cassettes pour que je puisse me concentrer, faire les choses proprement. Donc toujours sur l'évasion des enfants, la menace d'Eli. Donc je vous dis à tout de suite dès que j'aurai terminé la mission. Allez, à tout de suite.
Boss, we found weapons in the children's section of the living quarters. As you know, weapons are strictly off-limits. We've got some rule-breakers. The weapons we found were handmade. Blades ground out of knives and forks, a couple of bow guns built out of scrap, and explosives made using detergents. And get this. The explosives were tightly packed with nails. The kids put the blame on, you guessed it, Eli. I guess that's what he meant by consequences.
I questioned him about it, but this time he claimed they want to be put out on missions. Send us to the battlefield, he says.
Miller, enough is enough. You've protected him too much already. It's my turn to question him.
Protected?
What Eli's doing is issuing a threat. Comply with my demands or I'll respond with force.
But
it'll be war at this rate. Forks and soap aren't gonna kill us, but some of them will end up dead. Is that what you want? Now, I hate to say it, but they want to be on the battlefield. It's time you gave up this fantasy.
Stay down.
That should enable you to sneak past enemies.
Get back.
There, you see? Ignore his demands. Don't let him return to quarters. That attitude is contagious. We'd lose control over them for good.
For the time being, we've confiscated those handmade weapons. We're bumping up security and the number of psychiatric counselors. As for Eli,
he needs some very special care.
You mean solitary?
Well, we can't leave him in contact with the other kids. If you won't do it, I will. Boss, keep working on extracting those kids.
The kids you brought back to base have laid out the situation. They all escaped to each of their home villages, or were trying to get home, and lost their way. Not that homesickness is gonna explain everything we've seen.
Each of their home villages? They were trying to raise troops for the rebellion.
You really think these kids have an armed uprising in them?
You read the report of the security team member who had a rock thrown at him. There'll be a riot if we don't do something. And Miller, this is because you didn't act fast enough.
Fine. I'll admit you were right this time.
Seal off the kids' quarters from outside contact before it's too late.
All right.
Eli said his rebellion would start when the last kid is brought back, right? You better be ready to meet him head on if it really happens.
Yeah.
You should have left it to me in the first place.
Boss, they're just kid. We have a responsibility to see that those kids make it. It's not about feeling protective or the pros and cons. I hate kids. That's exactly what I heard from the people who raised me. People who abandoned me, more like. That's the spark that kept me going, you know? I wanted to show those adults what I was made of. Wanted to get back at them one day. But before I knew it, I was all grown up. Never saw it coming. All of a sudden, people treated me as an adult. Some adult I turned out to be. But I feel like if my life had been different, if the adults I knew had been different, I could have grown up better. Yeah, that's it, all right. I wanted to use those kids to test that theory. That's all this was. From their point of view, I'm no different from the assholes who gave me a hard time. When this is all blown over, I'll talk it out with them. If that's still possible. Boss, there are still kids out there. Bring them back safe.
Boss, it's me. Eli's revealed what he wants. He wants to speak with you. With Big Boss. He just said, bring my father here. Eli's too smart for his own good. No way to tell what he's thinking. All we know for sure is his men are important to him. That means we can use the escaped kids as leverage in any negotiation. Once you've brought the last one back, I'll interrogate him. If the kids do rise up, we'll meet them full force. End of story. I didn't want things to turn out like this. We could have prevented it, but it's too late now. If Eli means to take this all the way, he's gonna force us to do the same. Boss, go get that last kid.
Re tout le monde. J'allais vous dire, c'est bizarre parce qu'il y a personne, mais là j'entends un char là-bas, ouais, il est là-bas, ok. Et on a reçu un petit message de Iceman, donc on va aller le voir en direct, parce que moi j'ai embêté durant son let's play de Outlast, parce qu'il fait un let's play sur Outlast. Donc je vous invite à aller le voir sur sa chaîne, donc sa chaîne c'est The Iceman FR, je crois, tout attaché. Alors qu'est-ce qu'il me dit? Essaye de pas pleurer, Kero. Et oh, t'inquiète pas. Bon, je pense que ça va pas être durant cet épisode que je vais pleurer, donc il a un petit peu spoilé. Spoilé. Non, pas tellement. Ouais, bah je sais, on approche de la fin du let's play, je lis mes messages, je suis comme ça, bon, allez. YOLO. Donc, on va continuer les cassettes. Après cette petite interruption de Iceman, voilà, il a fait son intéressant durant mon... Durant mon let's play. Ah, il me les a repérés enfin, dit Doug. Il était temps. Donc, l'évasion des enfants, les craintes d'Ocelot. Ok. Donc, ben, là, cette fois-ci, je vous retrouve vraiment à la fin, dès que j'aurai fini cette mission. Allez, à tout de suite.
You know, when you brought back all the child soldiers who escaped, Eli knew they'd returned. Needless to say, nobody said a word to him. I guess they got a message to him somehow. Eli wasn't put in the corner in time out. He was locked up in that room, completely cut off from the outside world. Then how'd he find out? There's only one possibility I can think of. The Soviet Union has been researching military
targets
for psi phenomena. Psi? Things like psychokinesis and ESP, extrasensory perception. You mean moving objects without touching them? Knowing what card somebody's holding up? Psychic powers? Come on. I thought that was just another bunch of disinformation aimed at the West. Just bear with me a second. One type of ESP is telepathy. It's the ability to know another person's thoughts through nonverbal means. You're saying Eli read our minds? It's the only idea that doesn't involve someone getting to him. Ocelot. Look, Psy research isn't some hocus-pocus. It's all evidence-based, scientific... There's gotta be another explanation. Maybe one of the kids stuck a note to your back. I hope that's the case. But I am convinced that they have, or Eli has, a connection to some force we have yet to identify. You better watch yourself, boss. How am I supposed to do that? If he is depending on something for help, well, that's his Achilles heel. If you can figure out what that something is, you might be able to use it against him. I'll keep that in mind. Oh, and the medical team is looking after the kids left on Mother Base. For the moment, they don't seem too panicked. But boss, get this. Eli got those kids to plot their armed uprising as a diversion. All so he could steal Sahelanthropus and escape. That brat got us good. Set us up and knocked us down. And then there's that mystery kid who was with Eli. If those two working together, I'd say things won't be over for a long time yet.
Caution. Sandstorm approaching.
We finished decoding the informant's report. That floating kid we've run into a few times now. Looks like he was a test subject in clinical experiments. The Soviets called him the Third Boy. The Third Boy was brought to a lab on the outskirts of Moscow from Czechoslovakia, after which he was due to be sent to a research center in Leningrad, then Siberia, and finally an academic town in Novosibirsk. It doesn't appear that the researchers witnessed the talents we've seen from him, but nevertheless, he was quite the popular subject. His latent cognitive abilities suddenly awoke en route to Moscow. According to the report, the Third Boy was easily influenced by other individuals' biofields. Evil thoughts, in particular. They affected his mind like a virus.
You gotta extract him.
Extreme anger or resentment. Motives for revenge, in other words. Now, during the transport flight to Moscow, the boy was exposed to a powerful mental energy field coming from a certain individual. Ever since, being conscious of his powers, he's become a sort of energy generator. What's unique about him is the way his acute telepathic abilities get taken over by another person's will. The boy began to physically parasitize individuals experiencing extreme anger and codify the host's desires. This includes amplifying the host's natural strengths. Or, in accordance with the host's desires, he can also implant program code in another individual, making them a puppet, essentially. Human neural synapses transmit weak electrical currents between neurons. These electrical currents, though at a level difficult to observe, warp the magnetic field outside the body. The Third Boy is able to pick up these weak fluctuations. Contrary to psychotronics, which involves controlling the human mind, his abilities as a receptor are too high. The emotions he picks up from another individual are amplified and unleashed into his body as they recur in his brain. They turn into microwaves, which then affect the physical world, triggering paranormal phenomena like the spontaneous combustion of organic matter or psychokinesis.
Subject on board. Leave the rest to us.
While he's parasitizing a host, the boy's ego gets shut away, allowing the will of the host to take control of his powers, like some annoying static drowning out your own voice. That means he isn't responsible for what's been happening. Somebody's extreme anger has manifested through the Third Boy's powers in ways none of us could have predicted. which would mean this was going on somewhere around us. Looking back on it, a lot of things make sense now. The man on fire, Sahelanthropus, they both came to life thanks to the third boy's powers. Everything has been happening through him as a catalyst. We first saw him in the hospital on Cyprus. The boy parasitizing the man on fire's desire for revenge gave him his new abilities in return. He next appeared at the Hamid Fighters Fort where the honeybee was hidden. There, the boy parasitized Skullface's vengeful mind. He controlled Sahelanthropus, making it do whatever Skullface wanted. Same goes for when we extracted Emmerich onto the chopper. When he appeared at the Devil's House in Central Africa, Skullface's will controlled the man on fire via the third boy's powers. Everything is clear up to this point. And even the informant...
He's coming too. Roger that.
...the key within Serac power plant. Sahelanthropus suddenly became active, then crushed not only the man on fire, but Skullface as well. Surely neither of them could have been the host. Who else was at that location and bore anger more extreme than either of them? Whose will was controlling Sahelanthropus? According to the report, emotions transmitted in children's brains affect the surrounding magnetic field more strongly. Cerebral nerves are covered with insulation called myelin sheaths to increase impulse speed. The reason for this leakage has to do with the fact that children's myelin sheaths are still developing. So, how many children do you remember being there? Children with a burning desire for revenge and bearing a grudge against you. I can think of only one. Eli. We don't know what kind of life he's had, but the resentment he's shown toward adults is nothing short of extraordinary. The third boy resonated with Eli's mind. And that means Eli bore the strongest animosity of all individuals within the boy's reception range, estimated to be a 3-mile radius, beating out even Vulcan and Skullface. The third boy's probably remained hooked on Eli's anger since. Remember at the Devil's House, the third boy showed an interest in Shabani? That must have been his ego making a rare appearance. He may possess abilities far beyond anyone else in the world, but he's still a kid. Maybe them both being kids was enough to bring them together. And if so, maybe with Eli, he isn't feeding off him, but acting in symbiosis with him. So what kickstarted the third boy's powers? If we look at the location and time that his plane went down, we can make a pretty good guess. When the plane experienced the first anomaly, it gave an accurate report of its position to a control tower, due north of the Black Sea, 125 miles east of Kiev. Dead south in the Black Sea is Cyprus's Green Line. So the plane's position was directly north of the hospital where you'd been asleep for 9 years. And this anomaly was reported at exactly the same time that you woke up. The plane was enveloped in flame from the inside out. The fuselage burnt to ashes. There were no survivors, at least not publicly admitted. Your thoughts formed a synchronicity with the boy's psyche and were amplified inside his brain. That would have been more than enough to trigger his abilities. Your rage was like a big bang in his head, blowing the lid off his powers. The boy was then secretly moved to the lab outside of Moscow where Vulcan was comatose. There, Vulcan's thoughts resonated with the boy and he was awakened. Vulcan became the man on fire, hell-bent on getting revenge on you. His instincts led him straight to you. Skullface knew Vulcan from Operation Snake Eater, or perhaps from even before. Monitoring this pair of extraordinaries, he discovered the hospital and sent his assassin and XOF. Skullface was probably watching the situation from close by. Then, realizing how useful these two test subjects could be, he approached them. Reacting to Skullface's thirst for revenge, this time the boy let Skullface's will control Vulcan. Vulcan, at times driven by personal revenge, at times through Skullface's will, kept on moving, though his body was little more than dead meat. Perhaps there were moments where even your thoughts affected him as well. But without the boy's power, it was like the plug had been pulled from the socket. Everything was powered by anger, malice, revenge. This is how the end of the report sums things up. Both the third boy and the man on fire were originally test subjects of paranormal research for military applications. Like telekinetically controlling the leader of an enemy nation and making him launch a nuke. Or stopping the heart of someone on the wrong side of the Berlin Wall. Experimenting with latent human abilities. They were used as tools of the Cold War. The boy's only crime was being born with unique gifts. But he was sacrificed on the altar of war. His life reduced to slavery under other people's wills. Turned into a living weapon with no will of his own. And eventually the only emotion he could feel must have been the desire to get revenge for the hand he'd been dealt. Boss, it's you that awaken the boy's powers. But there's more to it than that. I guess the anger emanating from you was something he could truly relate to.
Ok les amis, donc voilà, j'ai attendu le temps que ça finisse les cassettes, donc vous voyez, ça s'est plutôt bien passé cette mission secondaire, donc voilà, donc dès qu'on prend son temps et tout, donc j'ai vu entre les lignes les cassettes, donc ça parlait un petit peu de Volgin, de Skullface, et comment Skullface connaissait Volgin depuis la mission Snake Eater, donc Snake Eater c'est MGS3, pour ceux qui connaissent. Ça parlait aussi un petit peu d'Eli et tout, sa colère envers Big Boss et tout, donc voilà. Et donc là on va se rendre à la Mother Base, voir s'il y a une petite cinématique qui s'enclenche pour terminer cet épisode. Sinon je vous retrouverai la prochaine fois directement dans le menu et ça enclenchera la cinématique, où ça on perdra pas de temps. Donc voilà, vous avez vu, on a écouté pas mal de cassettes, donc ça fait plaisir. Il nous en reste combien ? Il nous en reste 10, donc c'est raisonnable. Surtout que ça va assez vite, les cassettes, vous avez vu, c'est 2-3 minutes, grand maximum. À compléter 30% de la liste des animaux à protéger. Ok, à extraire une chèvre, cachemire. Ok, voilà, donc j'en ai profité aussi pour extraire quelques petits animaux. Et donc, on va retourner à la Mother Base et croisons les doigts pour qu'on ait la cinématique. On est à plus de 30 minutes d'épisode, donc voilà, on va voir s'il y a les cinématiques, puis après on se laissera là. Et la prochaine fois, promis, on attaque les choses sérieuses. Est-ce qu'on va pleurer? Est-ce qu'on va pas pleurer? Je ne sais pas. Et non, pas de cinématique. Ah, je suis déçu. Bon bah, du coup, je vous retrouverai la prochaine fois avec cette cinématique, promis. Et on se lancera dans la fin du jeu. Ce sera pas l'épisode final, hein, je pense pas. Non, c'est même sûr, ce sera pas l'épisode final la prochaine fois. Peut-être l'épisode 73, je pense. On vérifie s'il y a des petits diamants qui traînent. J'ai pas l'impression. Bon. Bah écoutez. On va se laisser là. Salut les mecs!
Boss, welcome home.
Ouais, on va se laisser là, écoutez, ça fait 30, presque 40 minutes d'épisode. Alors qu'est-ce qu'il me dit? Merci pour ce que tu as fait avec les diamants, maintenant ils peuvent reposer en paix. Voilà, les malheureux soldats que j'ai dû tuer donc, en zone de quarantaine quand il y avait l'épidémie encore. De rien les mecs. Enfin, de rien. C'est horrible un peu ce qui s'est passé, mais bon. Bref, j'arrête de papoter. Donc j'espère que cet épisode vous aura plu. Qu'est-ce qui s'est passé là? Il y a un truc qui s'est enclenché. Ah, peut-être qu'il parle de cette mission-là. Je pense. Attendez, je vérifie juste un truc. Ouais, je pense qu'il parlait de... parler de ça. Bref, donc je vous disais, j'espère que cet épisode vous aura plu. N'hésitez pas, comme d'habitude, à le commenter, à laisser un petit like, un petit pouce en l'air. Et je vous retrouve très bientôt pour l'épisode 72 avec du lourd, je vous le promets. Voilà. Donc, portez-vous bien tout le monde. Restez zen. N'hésitez pas à partager ma chaîne aussi si vous aimez ce que je fais, de vous abonner si ce n'est pas fait. Et je vous dis à très vite. Allez, salut tout le monde.